Welcome back to Microsoft Build Live. I am Damian Brady, and I'm joined at the moment by Edward Thompson. Ed, thanks for coming and joining me.
Hey, the pleasure's mine.
Awesome. So we talk together a lot about Azure DevOps and Azure Pipelines and all that kind of stuff. So it's awesome to have you on here to kind of talk about the product itself.
Awesome.
And some of the new stuff that's come out.
Yes.
A few open source information and things like that.
So yeah.
For those who don't know, what is Azure Pipelines?
Azure Pipelines, so let me take a step back.
Okay.
Let me talk about Azure DevOps.
Okay.
So Azure DevOps, we used to call it Visual Studio Team Services.
Mm-hmm.
And several months ago, I think it was September,
yep,
we decided to change the name. But we did more than just change the name, right? This was more than just a rebranding. Mm-hmm. What we actually did was we took Visual Studio Team Services and we broke it up. So, and the reason that we did that is because, you know, if you were using, say, GitHub for version control and you were happy with GitHub, and we got no problem with that,
yeah,
you might look at Visual Studio Team Services then, and you might say, well, Visual Studio Team Services has version control in it. I've got GitHub. I don't need VSTS. And you would, you know, ignore the fact that we've got a great continuous integration and continuous delivery pipeline for you that is totally agnostic about your version control,
yep,
system.
Yep.
So we took VSTS, we turned it into Azure DevOps, and we broke it up. So now there's separate products. There's Azure Boards for your work item tracking. There's Azure Repos for your version control. There's Azure Pipelines for your build and release.
Okay.
So that's where Azure Pipelines comes in. And the idea is that if you are using GitHub, then you can bring in Azure Pipelines just fine.
I'm so sorry, but I'm totally crashing your show.
And we've got Abel Wang. Hi, Abel.
Abel Wang. So this is one of my colleagues, Abel Wang, who has been, he deserves a round of applause. Good to see you on stage again, man.
Thank you so much. This is actually the first time since I've
been a while.
Awesome.
Yeah.
So I'm glad
really,
to see you.
Really sorry to interrupt.
No, I'm glad to see you.
This was just too good of an opportunity.
I think so too.
I'm going to jump on stage with them.
Yeah, you
I'm
are.
I'm now officially the third least knowledgeable person, most knowledgeable person on the stage, rather than the second. But thank you. So we were talking about Azure Pipelines as part of this product.
That's right.
And if your code's in GitHub,
yeah,
you don't need to put it in Azure Repos to use it.
That's right. That's yeah. right. So yeah, you can build your code, whether it's in GitHub, Azure Repos, you know, Bitbucket, a Git repository on a machine under one of the developers' desks. Please don't put a Git repository on a machine under a developer's desk. But if you do have that, you can still build it with Azure Pipelines. We don't care where the code is. So we'll take it, we'll build it, and then we'll deploy it.
Yep, for sure. And this is, so you're mentioning pipelines being used for, you know, if you have your code in GitHub, but this goes the other way around too. If you don't want to use pipelines, but you want to use Azure Repos, or you want to use Azure Boards, but not repos and pipelines and things like that, that also.
That's exactly right. Yeah, so that was the point of Azure DevOps. We want you to take whatever you want, whatever you need as part of your development process, whatever hole you have, and fill that.
Yep.
So Ed, what about people that are like totally invested in some other build, like Jenkins or whatever? I know people have spent hundreds of thousands of dollars building out their pipelines. Can they still use our product?
Absolutely. So, I mean, there's two ways that you could do that. Either you could point Jenkins at Azure Repos. That's fine. You can also have Azure Pipelines drive Jenkins. So we've actually got a plugin to, you know, a task for Azure Pipelines that is run a Jenkins job. And so whatever Jenkins infrastructure you have, you can take advantage of. You don't need to change that. You can take that build output and then use Azure Pipelines to deploy it, whether that's to Azure or, you know, another cloud, on-premises servers, that machine that's under the desk that's also serving Git repositories. Please don't deploy to machines under the desk either. But, you know, if you do, you can do that.
Yeah. So some of the Azure Pipelines has been around in some form or another. It was, you know, a build part of TFS and then Visual Studio Online and VSTS and so on for quite a while.
Almost 15 years.
It's better now than it used to be.
It's absolutely better now than it used to be.
I'm going to stick there. It's better than it used to be.
That's right. That's right.
And really powerful, especially for open source and things like that. But there were a few announcements to do with pipelines that came out at Build.
That's right.
During the keynote, you might have seen our boss, Donovan Brown, mentioned a couple of things. And one of them was one of my favorites. It was YAML for release definitions as well.
Yes.
So let's talk about YAML in general, like why AML format for defining your builds, why you would do it, and why that's important.
Right. So YAML is yet another markup language. It's you know, just a textual description of how a build can work. And the reason that you would want to do your build, define your build with YAML instead of like the visual designer. The visual designer is nice and easy, right? But if you actually have a file that describes the build, you can check that in alongside your code. And the great thing about that is that as your code changes and as the way you need to build that code changes, you'll always have that checked right in. So if you go to a different branch, let's say you need to, you know, I don't know, if you're servicing a box product and you need to come out with a 3.1, but you're busy working on, your team's working on 4.0, they've totally changed the way builds work for 4.0. When you go check out the branch for 3.1, you need to still be able to build that branch too. So the actual description of the way builds work is checked right in.
And that's, yeah, that can be really valuable.
It's incredibly powerful.
When somebody clones your code, and I think I like the way that you put this to me, Abel, when we were talking before. When somebody clones your code or forks your code, they're not just getting the code that you wrote, the application, they're getting the way to build that application too.
Right.
Which is really powerful, especially in open source.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah. I just want to jump back really quickly because we have a question from somebody who's watching online. And it's a question that I've been asked a few times, we talked about before. Azure repos is Git repositories?
Yes.
GitHub also is Git repositories?
Yes.
Do we need to move everybody to one or the other? Are they going away? What's the story
there? No. Nobody's going away. Nobody's going anywhere.
Good.
At least not, you know, as far as I can see. So I think GitHub is great. I used to work at GitHub. I love GitHub. GitHub is incredible for open source. GitHub is incredible for inner source workflows and collaboration. Azure repos, there is no version control provider on the planet that can handle the Git repository that is Microsoft Windows, except Azure repos. So they've both got strengths. If you're happy with what you've got, there's no reason to think about changing it.
And this is the kind of the trend, right? If you're happy with what you're using, we're not forcing you to use the entirety of Azure DevOps, which is why we break it up in the first place.
That's exactly right.
Yeah.
So I have a question about the GitHub versus the Azure repos. If I'm starting a greenfield project, which direction should I go? Is there like one that, a certain reason that I'd be like, ooh, I want to go Azure repos more because it makes more sense?
Sure.
Or is it just like it really doesn't matter which direction you go?
I think, so if you're doing an open source project, I would absolutely do GitHub because that's where everybody expects to find your open source.
Okay.
Right? That's where everybody wants to do their collaboration.
Yep.
If you already have other projects in Azure repos, then why have two different systems?
Right, right.
But really, it comes down to preference at some point. Do you like the way you pull requests work, collaboration works on GitHub? Do you like the way it works on Azure repos? Just go with whatever makes you happy.
Yeah.
I mean, we got too many problems. We've got tabs versus spaces. We've got YAML versus JSON. We don't need to worry about GitHub versus Azure repos. Just go with what makes you happy.
And it's Git, right?
Yeah.
It's Git. So I derailed us a little bit on that. We were talking about how the YAML lives in your lives in your code. Mm-hmm. And that's the same whether it's in GitHub or Azure repos. You don't need to use Azure repos to put the YAML build definition in.
That's exactly right.
Yeah, it can live in GitHub alongside.
Sure.
But one of the other announcements that came out was kind of an extension of what that YAML could do in that we now have multi-stage YAML definitions.
That's exactly right.
Multi-stage pipeline.
That sounds kind of abstract when
it does, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Do you like how I did that?
What's that?
Abstract, so you could explain it.
Yeah. So yeah, just tee that up for me. So the idea is that YAML is good for builds, and YAML is great for builds. But what if you could do releases with YAML too? Because it used to be until yesterday, so 2 days ago, two long days ago, you had a tab over in Azure DevOps that said builds and one that said releases.
Yep.
Now you have a tab that says pipelines. So we're bringing these two things together because what is a build and what is a release? This starts to get a little questionable, especially if you're automatically deploying to a staging server on every merge. Mm-hmm. And some people do that. And so it gets a little hazy what's a build and what's a release. So we now have multi-stage YAML pipelines. So you can do a build and then you can do a release, and you can define that release in YAML just like you can define the build in YAML. And that's really, really powerful. If you don't like that, that's fine. You can still use the visual editor. Mm-hmm. That's fine too. But I really like being able to define my releases in YAML. The other thing that we've added is if you're overwhelmed by YAML, as I often am, I like it, but it can get a little dense. Over on the right-hand side, when you click Edit on a YAML pipeline, now over on the right-hand side of the editor, you can actually see some tasks, and you can click on that task, and you can actually enter some values. It'll ask you, like, you know, if you want to deploy to AKS, what's the name of your container registry?
Yeah.
What's the name of your AKS pod? And you type that in, and you click Add, and it will actually insert YAML into that file. So you're kind of getting a bit of the best of both worlds when it comes to YAML being able to check in your configuration as code, and being able to do some editing without having to memorize how all the YAML works.
Which is fantastic, because another way that we used to do it quite often was you edit it in the visual editor, and then you export the YAML.
Right, right.
And then you have this disconnect, I guess, between the visual side and the other one. So this kind of closes that gap somewhat.
It's starting to. We're going to do more. This is just the first piece of that.
Yeah, it definitely helps things. One of the other things that I think is really worth mentioning in the last few minutes we have is the open source offerings that we have for Azure DevOps in general.
Yes.
Yeah. So can you talk a bit about that?
Yeah. So we rely on open source on the Azure DevOps team. You know, so many of the components that we use are open source. And so many of the team members actually contribute to open source projects. I work on an open source project. I'm a core contributor to a project called libgit2. Mm-hmm. And we want to give back to the open source community because we take so much. And so one of the things that we have is a very generous build offering, pipeline offering for open source projects. Yep. So we offer open source projects 10 parallel builds and unlimited build minutes per month. And I think that's the most generous in the industry.
I've been told that.
Yeah, and so that's for our hosted build agents, and we run, you know, in the cloud in Azure. We have Linux VMs, Windows, and Mac OS. So whatever kind of application you're building, you can build it with Azure Pipelines, and it's free for open source projects, completely free.
Which is very cool. And it's also free to an extent for private projects, right?
That's right, that's right. You don't need to be an open source project to get the free offering. It's just not as generous, if I'm completely honest.
Yeah, that's right. Abel, have you seen any of the other build announcements that have gone on around Azure DevOps? I think there was, what was the other one we were talking about before? There was one on pipeline analytics or something like that came out.
The pipeline analytics.
One that I'm actually excited about is AAD and also GitHub authentication. They work for each other
great.
Now, right?
Right, right. Yeah.
That's cool.
Just like, you know, if you are in GitHub, we're trying to make that transition between Azure, the rest of the Azure DevOps family, and GitHub a little bit easier. So AAD integration, login from GitHub to Azure. We've got a new Azure Boards extension in the GitHub Marketplace.
That's right.
So better integration between Azure Boards and GitHub pull requests.
Yeah, there's a bunch of stuff that's come out. How do people get started? If they want to actually try this stuff out, they've got a project in GitHub or something like that, they want to try it out, where do you start?
Yeah, the easiest way, if you've got a project in GitHub, is the GitHub Marketplace. It's up at the top of the GitHub, you know, menu, Marketplace, and then just search for Azure Pipelines, and it'll just walk you through the getting started. You don't need to have an Azure DevOps account already. You can just create one on the fly, and you'll go from there. It'll choose the type of template for your repo, and it'll just build you a pipeline right there.
We may have some videos that show that.
One or two.
We've got one or two videos that show that, yeah. Those templates as well, they're built around kind of your nice, easy path
yes.
for the languages that it's discovered. And stuff.
Yeah, that's right.
But it's incredibly extensible, right?
Totally extensible, yeah. I mean, if you want to add tasks and define them that way, if you want to just run some scripts, that's no problem, whether that's PowerShell or Bash or even CMD, I guess, if you wanted to do that, you can do that.
One thing as well, you mentioned hosted pipelines or hosted agents, Windows, Mac, and Linux as options, and you can run your own, right? You can run your self-hosted agents.
Sure, sure, yeah.
And I think there's a few different flavors as well, so you can download them not just for Windows, Linux, Mac. Is what ARM is supported?
You could run an ARM job. The other thing you could do, and this is what I do with my open source projects, because I'm old and I write C.
Uh-huh.
Right. So we build on Mac, Linux, and Windows, but we also build on Linux for ARM because we have people embedding our software on their phones. And so we actually use QEMU because our hosted build agents are real virtual machines, and you can run another emulator inside of there. So you can run QEMU, emulate an ARM, and not spend a penny out of pocket. Now, if you want, you could, of course, run it on a Raspberry Pi under your desk. But, you know, this is how I don't feel good about infrastructure under a desk.
I put it on top of my desk when I did that.
That's
though.
Better.
That's better. Yep.
Yeah.
That's, you can see the light.
That's acceptable.
Yeah. Yep. So you kind of, it's not just those environments and the tasks that we give you and the templates we give you.
Right.
You can do your own tasks, any scripts that you want to run, and then run them on any kind of infrastructure as
that's
well.
That's exactly right. Yeah. Whether it's on-prem, cloud, a mix and match, that's fine.
And even, not sure if we're allowed to mention this, but even other people's clouds.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. You know, you can deploy to another cloud. You can deploy to on-prem. You can build in another cloud. You can build on-prem. Whatever you want to do.
Yeah, definitely.
Can I ask another GAML release question? Because I'm super excited about this.
Yes. Right?
So, and I wasn't paying too much, don't tell Donovan this, but I wasn't paying too much attention during the keynote. Because I know our release pipelines, what you can do in them is extensive. There's so much cool things that you can do. How much of that can we do with the YAML releases? And are we planning on, or can we do everything, or are we planning on slowly building that out?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes to both. you can do everything, and you will see more growth, especially in that marketplace. You know, we just
fantastic.
Added the go to AKS, very straightforward in YAML.
Yeah.
You're going to see more better coming to YAML.
Yeah. Cool. So there is plenty more to talk about, but we are out of time. Thank you so much, Ed, for joining us here.
Thank you.
And thank you as well, Abel,
thanks,
for your
Abel,
surprise experience.
For crashing the,
crashing the party. And everybody else, be right back. Stay with us.